sun. Felt like a million, felt like number one. The height of summer, I never felt that strong, like a rock. I was 18, didn't have a care, working for peanuts, not a dime to spare. But I was leaning solid everywhere, like a rock. My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right, like a rock. Like a rock. I was strong as I could be, like a rock. Nothing ever got to me, like a rock. I was something to see, like a rock. And I stood arrow straight, unencumbered by the weight of all these hustlers and their schemes. I stood proud, I stood tall, high above it all. I still believed in my dreams. Sometimes where they've gone. And sometimes late at night, oh, when I'm bathed in the firelight, the moon comes calling a ghostly way, and I recall. I recall, like a rock, standing arrow straight, like a rock, charging from the gate, like a rock, carrying the weight, like a rock. Oh, like a rock, a soul. Like a rock, hard against the wind. Like a rock, I see myself again. Like a rock, I'm
Happy Thursday, February the 11th. Three more days to Valentine's Day. That was Bob Seger, a little older music for you guys, but what a wonderful classic song. It does kind of relate to you guys because he's talking about being lean and strong and in charge of his life at age 18, and then fast forwards to 20 years later, wondering where all those years went. Well, it's been a little more than 20 years for me, but I think about things, especially around Valentine's Day. I have this year, a really strong, committed relationship as a Valentine. And as I might have mentioned, she's 6,000 miles away in the Philippines. And that makes things tough. There's a term in the modern lexicon called LDR, long distance relationships, also known as lockdown relationships after COVID-19. Yeah, so anyway, I hope all of you have a nice Valentine's. Doesn't necessarily mean you're involved with anybody, because as we know in psychology, the first person you need to be in love with is yourself. And of course, we don't mean this in a narcissistic way. We mean it to be in a healthy way, that you feel good about yourself. You're doing what you want to be doing. You're emotionally supportive of yourself when you make mistakes. Okay, big deal, move on, pick yourself up and move on. In the intro, I mentioned this concept of grit, G-R-I-T, grit. Grit is a phenomenon where people who have grit are the kind of people who engage in their world, and when they get knocked down and they have failures, they learn from them and they move on. They don't stop pursuing their desires and academic desires or personal desires just because there's been some setbacks. People have interviewed the most successful people in the world, trying to get an idea as to if they have anything in common. And the one thing that they do have in common is that many of them say, I have always learned more from my mistakes than I ever have out of my victories. And you listen to that and you say, what? And the idea is, you are engaging in the world, you're going to make mistakes, you're going to make false assumptions, but you try them out. I mean, it's really like the scientific method. You come up with a thesis in life. This is what this person wants. This is what I want from this person, or this is what I want in my own life. This is what I think is a good idea. And it doesn't turn out. And so in science, we just say, that's good. It's good to get a negative result because it tells you where you don't need to go when you're doing research. And that's what, you know, entrepreneurs and CEOs will tell you. It's good when you make a mistake because it tells you where you don't want to go. It tells you that that's not an option, a good option for what you're trying to do. So don't feel dismayed by the fact that you may have been in a relationship and you thought it was going to be a good thing and it turned out not to be a good thing. And here you are on February 14th, or soon to be, 2021, and you're not involved in a relationship where you had been in the past, and you're feeling not happy about that. Well, if you're a person with grit, you move on and you continue to do what you need to do to take care of yourself. Now, if you were to ask me the question, out of your years and years of teaching and years of life as a psychologist or as a an attorney or even as an investigator, what one thing do you think is the most predictive of somebody's success? And of course, I know the answer because I've read the research. The answer is grit. If you're the kind of a person who has grit, you're going to be a success. It's just a fact of life because you're not going to quit, even though failures hurt, and especially along the lines of emotional failures in relationships may take a while to mend from that. You will prevail, and a single man at my age, having gone through some failures in my past, I am hearkened and I'm delighted by the fact that this Valentine's Day is going to be better and more fulfilling and more satisfying, even though there's a huge distance between us than I have ever had. So don't give up. I do have some grit, which is how I got to be where I am. So I'm very happy about that. And I hope you'll learn from that. And as Bob Seger was telling us, when you look back 20 years in the future about this time, you'll want to remember that the reason that you had the life that you're going to have when you're 38 or 40 is because you had the grit to do the things you needed to do in your family life, in your social life, in your academic life to accomplish the goals that you wanted. And this particular class, we don't have anybody who is particularly older. We obviously remember one of our students admitted she was in her past 35 years old, which to you probably seems like old. To me, it's like, wow, that's really young. And so, by the way, I went to law school when I was 37. After I had practiced psychology for 10 years. So the opportunities are there, and if you have grit, you will accomplish that. And there's another word of the wise for yourself, loving yourself. If you have the opportunity to attend therapy, if you know somebody or you found somebody that's a good therapist, which I will admit is not the easiest thing to do, but there's no shame in seeking self-help. As a graduate student in psychology, all my non-psychology major friends would always tell me, oh, I know why you're going to become a psychologist, so you can figure out what your problem is. And I said, well, yeah, you're probably right, but you know, at least one of us is going to solve our problems and be in charge of our life. So there's no shame in seeking help. If you had, if you were not feeling well today and didn't think you were going to get over it without some assistance, you would not hesitate to go to the emergency room or go to your family care physician and try to get some kind of assistance and help. You should have the same attitude about shoring up your mental health, because it's just another function of your body, and there should not be the stigma of, oh, you went to see a therapist or you went to see a psychologist. Well, yeah, but you went to see a urologist. You went to see a gynecologist. You know, it's the same thing. So even though we have social constructs which look differently at it. But all right, we're finishing up chapter 4. I want to sort of go over a little bit of review because basically the page we were on when we stopped on Tuesday, and that is on wrapping up attachment. And here we go. The quality of attachment during infancy lays the foundation for healthy development in a variety of life realms. Realms. God, that's a hard word for me to say this morning. Still, attachment capacities and even our human brains are malleable, which means they're movable, changeable, and negative pathways can be altered. As long as the deprivation is not too profound and the wider world provides special help. Absolutely. I mean, if you've been profoundly, well, none of you are, because here you are students in college. So if you had some of that deprivation that was so severe that you couldn't overcome it, well, you wouldn't be here. No one doubts that you've had challenges in your life, and any thinking person, any rational, critical thinking person will tell you you're going to have challenges in the future. Matter of fact, in this class, when we get to the age group of people in their 50s and 60s, I will tell you that one of the things that predicts a happier life in your 50s and 60s or 70s is that you have been confronted with serious, challenging emotional situations and you've overcome them. Obviously, you're too young to have experienced 50 years or let's just say 30 years as an adult. But let me tell you, this is what the stats show, and common sense, if you think about it, it does make a lot of sense. If you or someone else had a pretty relaxed life with no big challenges to it, and then you get into your 50s and your 60s, and this person that you fell in love with in your 20s or 30s happens to die, you're going to be crushed, as we all would be. The big difference is, if you have never had challenges like having loved and lost, or challenges like a loved one, a parent, a grandparent, somebody really close to you, a friend, dies in a car accident prematurely, of course, somebody dies of COVID. If you haven't worked through that experience, if you haven't had the experiences of really loving a job and getting fired from it or let go because of financial problems, or wanting to get a wonderful job and thinking you're going to get it and then you don't, these things are crushing to you emotionally. And people with grit, they're not living in a fantasy world. They realize that something happened and maybe they don't understand it. You know, I practiced law for 20 years, and I did 126 jury trials. And that may not sound like a lot, 126 over 20 years, but there are most attorneys go through their entire career never having done a trial at all. And jury trials are, of course, even more complicated and important than just a trial in front of the judge. And you learn a lot about yourself and you learn a lot about life when you do these things, because when you win the verdict that you want, you're of course delighted. And when you lose the verdict that you want, you're set back, kind of devastated. And if you do like I did, if the jury would allow you to go talk to them after the trial, I would go talk to them. A lot of attorneys won't do this because they know what I know, but they look at it differently. And what I know and they know is you go in to a jury and you talk about, okay, you know, what was the compelling evidence? What made you really think the other person's view, the other attorney's position was the right one? And then when they tell you, you are truly crushed, because they will say things like, remember that witness that was in the red dress that you called? I say, yeah. Well, we didn't really like her. She looked like she was dressed like she was, you know, a loose woman or something. And we just didn't believe her testimony because she, you know, just didn't look very nice.
No, this is a skill you're going to be learning. So these are the materials you received.
Well, on your initial material live. You don't have to listen to it on tape.
You have a new adapter. I'm not sure if I gave you the one with
cut your mic there, Crystal.
Plain white. I mean, clear on both sides, but it's the same thing. And then you have a clear holder. Okay. What we need to do.
Okay. Maybe Crystal is multitasking. Listen to two instructors at the same time. That's fine. Anyway, you learn that people make decisions in a jury sometimes based on just totally ridiculous things, just stupid things. And you think, how could I have known that? You know, or somebody said or didn't say something, the question that wasn't asked or something, and you think, why would I ask that question? That's a stupid question. Obviously not stupid to the jury. Or when you win a case and they'll tell you something and it's equally stupid, and you think, out of all that work and all that argument I made, you made your decision correctly, but on something that was tangential to the important issue of the case. And that's why attorneys don't go talking to juries, because you get so pissed off that the jury makes some decision based on some ancillary mundane issue that didn't have to do with the main case. It's just incredibly frustrating. So a lot of people don't go ask. So I used to ask because I could handle it. Yes, it is upsetting, but it's another example of having grit, having a setback. The stakes are pretty high when you're in criminal cases. I was a prosecutor and a criminal defense attorney. Either side, pretty high stakes. If you lose a prosecution, I didn't lose many prosecutions, and I certainly never lost any big ones. On the defense side, I did lose some. I have a guy right over here in Las Cruces in prison for murder. And, you know, whether I believe he did it or not is not the issue. I don't believe he did it, but I think the facts showed, tended to show that he didn't do it, and the state did not prove their case. But because there was a dead girl involved and he was the only one charged, I think the jury was motivated to find somebody guilty. And since he was the only one charged, he got found guilty. So that's pretty devastating, because now somebody's spending their life over there in Las Cruces in that prison down Southern, is what it's called, Southern New Mexico prison. And he was young when he was convicted. He was in his 20s. So his whole entire life is going to be sent over there in Southern New Mexico prison. That is hard to deal with, but it's hard to deal the victim's family. It's hard to deal with the fact that they're young, beautiful, uprising daughter was murdered. And that's a permanent thing too. So they'll have to live with that for as long as they live. So it's hard on both sides of the equation, the prosecution side and the defense side. So, all right, wrapping up attachment. I was looking at these questions, tying it all together. See if I can answer them myself before I ask you. List an example of proximity seeking in distress in your own life within the past few months. Well, remember, proximity seeking is when you seek to be close to somebody in times of stress. Children do it. They cling on to mom's legs or they run to dad for a hug, crying, and they expect, hopefully, and receive, hopefully, the kind of TLC they need to calm them down over that social incident. If you have any doubts about this, you should go to a playground where kids are actively there and parents are present or caretakers, and watch what happens, because kids will be playing, they'll fall off the some kind of apparatus or something, and it's a little bit more startling than it is painful if you just happen to, you know, fall off a particular apparatus or something. And the first thing they do is look up to the person that brought them, because it's like, oh, mom, I fell. And if mom looks at them and smiles, okay, you're all right, it's all good, the kid will go, okay, and they'll go back and play. They want that visual, maybe the auditory as well, assurance that everything's okay, you're all good, they go back and play. However, if mom or the caretaker gets emotionally upset, and when the kid turns around and mom is, bam, that's it. The kid's going to start wailing and maybe run back to mom. And I'll never forget such a tragic story, funny, tragic. I was at a friend of mine's house when he was having a Super Bowl Sunday kind of thing. And this one family that was there, let's say they have some parenting issues. And because they have parenting issues, their children are behavioral problems. And this child was running recklessly through the house, which of course is not their house, and was chasing something, I don't know, a ball or something. This kid's about 6. And I say, he was so interested in that, he didn't realize that the room was, the wall was there, and this heavy wood piece of furniture, which happened to be holding a TV, he ran into that piece of wood so hard that you could obviously hear it in the other room. I happened to be in the room where it happened. I saw it happen. He hit it with such force, it backed him off about 3 feet from the percussion. Boom! And I thought, oh my God, here it comes. He turns around and looks at mom. Mom's in a conversation. Mom looks at him and just goes, pays no attention to him. And the kid just gets up and walks away like nothing happened. Well, you could say, wow, that's good. You know, the mom's not like babying him and, you know, encouraging him to cry. The behavioralist would say, yeah, that's the way you got to be. Well, those of us who are not behavioralists would say, the guy hit his head in a tremendous amount of force. Couldn't you have said something like, Jimmy, you need to slow down a little bit, but I'm glad you're okay, and, you know, whatever. You can reinforce the fact that they didn't wail, but you could show that you're concerned about them and you're happy that they're not hurt, rather than just ignore, in essence, ignore the kid, which is obviously one of the reasons those children are so out of control, because their parents are very lenient and they let them do pretty much what they want to do. And that is a recipe for disaster. Reminds me of a video. If we have time, I think we'll have time today because I don't think we have that much to talk about. I'll look up that video and show it to you because it's really classic. Okay. Let me write that down. I'll forget because it's a little bit off the plans. Okay. Next question is just, you know, list what level of attachment. And I think that's that particularly important. Here's a better one. Match the terms to the following definition. And you have four definitions: social referencing, working model, synchrony, and strange situation. So let's take number one, social referencing. The answer to that one is a toddler keeps looking back at his parent while exploring a playground. That's pretty much the example I gave you. Number two, a working model. Working model is an elementary school kid keeps an image of their parent in their mind to calm them down. So that's sort of that self-calming thing. Not that we talk about a baby in a crib doing self-calming, but more of a cognitive self-calming. You know, remember the old term, what would Jesus do? Well, you can think in your mind when a conflict occurs, you would say, well, what does mom want me to do? What would make my dad proud to my reaction to what I do in this situation? Those kinds of things are calming to you because maybe your father said to you, like I used to say to my children, this too shall pass. This too shall pass. And yes, it's tough. Yes, it's unpleasant, but it's not forever. You've got over it and it's going to get better. The next one, synchrony, is a mother and a baby relate to each other as if they're totally in tune. That's the dance behind me, the Matisse, famous Matisse painting about the dance. And then four, the strange situation. You have a video on that by Mary Ainsworth's not in the video, but it is a video of the strange situation using that concept that Mary Ainsworth came up, who was a graduate student, and I believe John Bowlby was her mentor, but even if he wasn't her mentor, he was in the program and she learned his concepts and then went on and refined them, which is always exciting when one of your students learns something from you and goes out and develops their own aspect of it, which adds to the understanding of it. Okay. So I was about to get into the conversation on Tuesday about this thing about a social economic status, SES, and how this author really puts a huge impact on the fact that poverty is, could be devastating to children's development. You hear kind of these broad brush arguments that, oh, people that come from poor families, they don't have a chance, you know, they don't have the internet and they don't have this, they don't, you know, their parents are not taking them to to the Natural Museum or the Children's Museum downtown. They're not taking them on vacation to wonderful places like New York or Chicago or LA, or if they have a lot of money, Paris or Dubai or Philippines. Wonderful places to go visit. Yes, if you have the financial capabilities. I used to say this to my intro class, face-to-face classes, which also talks about the fact that mental illness seems to be more prevalent among lower class people because of all these resources. The same kind of resources that are denied their children are also denied them, and that could be very depressing. One of the most obvious groups of people who get depressed are single parents because they have the responsibility of a child and they don't have the other partner who created the child there. And maybe they have a strong family, maybe they don't. One of the really nice things about Hispanic culture, which I have to assume is a carryover from the Spanish influence, and which includes religious beliefs. Many people in Mexico are Catholics. Many people in Philippines are Catholic. And unlike the United States, for instance, some of you who know something about the Philippines, religion is really practiced very strongly, and the government doesn't have our constitution, which wants to separate religious affairs from governmental affairs. The government is, and religion in the Philippines are very much closely tied in, much more than the United States. And I mentioned that it's not that I disagree with the fact that poverty is not going to be a positive contributor to a child's development, but it's not the only thing, because there are plenty of people, and you might be one of them, there are plenty of people who come from poor backgrounds who are completely emotionally stable, adjusted, and doing well, even though they don't have a lot of money. I mentioned to you, two of my children's mother is from Mexico. She's came from a very poor family and a single parent family because her mother died early from cancer. And she is well-adjusted, her sisters and are well-adjusted, and when you say accomplished great things, maybe they don't have a PhD in their family, and they don't have a BA in their family, they don't have an associate's degree in their family, but that might be your family too. You might be the first person in your family to be pursuing an academic career here. So you are more or less well-adjusted. I'll let you make that decision. I'm not making any assumptions. I'm assuming that you have obviously a lot of strengths to be able to attend this class and others, and you have a degree and you have a program, and I'm pretty willing to bet that your family is supportive of you in that endeavor, even if they didn't have the benefit of that. My ex-wife has a sixth grade education. I considered her very smart. She understood a lot about human relations. She was a great mother and continues to be a great mother. I act like she's dead, but she's not dead. She's just not married to me. So And that shows she's pretty smart too, right? All right. So there are plenty of stories of people who've overcome abject poverty because even in a single parent, I mentioned our former Health and Human Services child neurosurgeon as an example, who grew up in a government housing without a father and a mother who worked cleaning houses. So it was a poor environment, but the love that she gave him, he took a lot of strength from his church, his belief, and turned out to be a world-renowned neurosurgeon. So you don't have to be a world-renowned neurosurgeon to be successful and happy in life, but he's an example of somebody who overcame the SES portion of his life. A lot of people, when I was an investigator, one of my closest friends was a guy who got into the Department of Children and Family Services early on, and they let him in without a degree. All that his education stopped in high school, but yet he was a social worker in the Department of Children and Family Services. Why is that? Because he was a learned man, he was an empathic man, and he worked, he happened to be African-American, and he worked very well with clients, including African-Americans, which did make up a fair portion of our caseload at the department in Illinois, because Illinois has a bigger African-American population than, of course, Texas or New Mexico. But Texas does have it because Texas has big cities. So there are enclaves like in Houston, large Black population, and Dallas. And so, and then of course there's poor people regardless of what race you are. So there's more poor white people in the United States than there are poor Black people. When we're talking a little bit about daycare centers or daycare homes, I highlighted a sentence here that says, children are more apt to be securely attached to a caregiver when that person has been there a long time. So if you had a child in a daycare center or daycare home and you had to keep changing for whatever reason, you had to keep changing, then the kind of attachments that could have occurred in a situation, or many of you might have relatives that live in your home, grandmother or grandfather or an uncle or something. If they are living in your home for a long time and a child gets attached to them, then that's a great thing. But if they were just a relative who was staying for a couple months and then they left, well, that would be less so than somebody who was consistently there. One U.S. comparison suggested that when teachers reported having minimal adequate wages and paid time off, toddlers in that particular class were happier and better behaved. So this was a comment about childcare workers, people who work in daycare homes. It's usually obviously their home, but sometimes they seek assistance from friends or family, and of course daycare centers. So the argument is, if you had daycare centers and they paid better, then you wouldn't have necessarily have so much turnover, and you might get a better quality person in the daycare center. And of course, all those things are true. Daycare prices are pretty steep. So you have to have a lot of money to even send a child to daycare. One of the things that my experience in Mexico and my experience in the Philippines has been that relatives will tend to help you. Obviously, I have a loved one and a child, so it makes her a single parent over there in the Philippines. And but she gets a lot of help from her parents and her sisters, who and her brothers for that matter, who help. So it's very much a family-oriented focus, just like a lot of people in Mexico are. Reach out and tios, tias, primos, whatever, help when somebody needs a help, and especially when it comes to childcare. Have a child with somebody they know, somebody you can trust as a parent, can take care of them. Just ask yourself how many of you had a significant relationship with a grandmother or a grandfather. I'll tell you, whatever percentage it is, it's a lot higher than non-Hispanics in the United States. The only other group that sort of has a history of taking care of each other's kids are in the African-American community. So that's one thing that is shared. But I think my experience with the Mexican culture and the Filipino culture is they're much, much higher percentage of family members helping other family members, especially when it comes to childcare. There is a list of choosing a daycare center, a checklist of things to consider. That's really a nice checklist. If you you have this book on in digital form, so this is the kind of checklist you might want to either make a copy of it or remember that you have this digital book and you can refer back to it when you get a situation where you might want to. Now, what we were talking about, daycare centers and homes and all that stuff, go back and review it. Wouldn't hurt you to do that. I wrote in this Adam Lanza down here, which maybe you don't remember his name, but he's the guy who in high school was being homeschooled by his mom, and he took a gun to a school and killed a bunch of five-year-olds and a couple of staff members before he was killed. And you try to go back and do a post hoc analysis of what the hell went wrong with Adam Lanza. We don't really know, or at least I don't really know. I haven't seen much in the media about him. He sounds like he was a kid that was on the autism spectrum disorder, and he had a lot of problems in school. His parents were very wealthy, at least the father was very wealthy, and he had, unlike what the author Berger is talking about with SES problems, Adam Lanza did not have SES problems. His father was very wealthy and his parents divorced, and the father gave mom the house and paid the kind of child support where she didn't have to work. And all she had to do in life was to take care of Adam. And apparently that didn't work out so well. I'm not going to be like Bruno Bettelheim and blame it on mom, but somebody should have had some professional intervention with this kid. There was all sorts of signs that he was emotionally disturbed and not well adjusted. The reason she homeschooled him is because the school kept kicking him out of school because he was such a behavior problem. Now, one of the things he was interested in was guns. And mom thought, well, that's a common denominator. If I could get interested in guns, then maybe that's something he and I could do, and we can sort of help this bonding, attachment, relationship. So she had several guns in the house. She would take Adam and they would go practice in the range. And some people are very critical of her for doing that. Again, I'll tell you my prejudice. My prejudice is guns don't kill people. People kill people. And yes, guns make it easier to kill people. But if they don't have a gun, they can kill them with a knife. They can drive over their bodies with a car. They can do a lot of things. So if they're intent on killing somebody, not having a gun is not going to stop them. And having a gun is not going to say, you know what? I got a gun. I should just go shoot that guy. Yeah, that's it. Now, I mean, does that happen sometimes, especially like in road rage incidents or something, and somebody gets killed over cutting somebody off in traffic or something? It's, yes, guns make death occur easier, but they don't seem to make death occur more frequently in the, just because of their presence. So, but that's a whole another argument, political argument. You can fall on either side of that. But if you are mentally driven to harm somebody, you will find a way. Okay. Socialization, she talks about, you know, the whole idea that part of growing up, part of development is social development, and children mimic others. They learn things by watching others interact. Another big controversy is, does children watching violent movies or playing violent video games lead to violence? And my position on that is basically the same. It can be, because if you're interested in violence, because you're a violent person, maybe your autonomic nervous system is the kind of thing that wants more stimulation. And one way to get stimulation is go beat somebody up. You might like playing violent videos because you get to kill people, you get to smash them. You might like going to movies back in the old days when we went to movie theaters that are violent. Just like if you like scary movies, you go see scary movies, and many of them are violent with stabbings and killings and beheadings and all that kind of stuff. So the last thing I want to talk about from the book is the fact that this attachment, which occurs between zero and day one and more or less 2 years of age, not only does that affect you, that child, immediately right then, but we've talked about what are the future ramifications of that. You have a writing assignment on that issue, and hopefully you've looked at that and watched some of those videos and done the reading. If you need more time to complete that assignment, let me know. If you're predisposed to do something violent, you probably take an interest in things that are violent. But the vast majority of people who play violent video games and watch violent movies, it doesn't make them into a violent person. The reason that we find out after the fact that some people who have committed serial murders happen to be aficionados of violent things, then we say, oh, well, that's a cause and effect. Well, that's kind of myopic. It's against the basic principles of scientific endeavors. You should go look at kids. I remember one specifically when a psychologist was interviewing this young kid about 8, and he was really into this video game, violent, killing, counting the numbers, the dead body count and all this kind of stuff. And then he's interviewed by this psychologist, one that wasn't particularly smart, and said to him, hey, Jimmy, you know, when you really score well. And they say, oh, yeah, I used to be at this level. Now I'm at this level. And, you know, my older brother, I even beat him. I'm better at it than him. And he says, well, when you kill all those people and you burn them and cut them up and all that stuff, do you ever, and you're really good at it in this game, do you ever think that might happen in your real life? That you might be interested in doing that in real life? And the camera shows the face of the kid, and the kid looks at him like, it's a game, you know, duh. And, you know, the psychologist writing, oh, it's a game. It's like, come on, dude, it's a game. I don't think I'm going to go do this. I watch a war movie. That means I want to go create a war. No, but just remember, people who are prone to violence and like that kind of excitement, that sort of antisocial behavior, they probably do watch violent movies. If you, you know, when I teach forensic psychology, you know, we all know that Ted Bundy was a serial killer and murdered, raped and murdered a lot of young women. And he, the night before he died, you know, brought in this Christian minister and did an interview with him. He demanded that this guy come see him. So the guy did. And he told him, hey, I think the reason I am the way I am is because I had this childhood and I was exposed to pornography at an early age and sexual assault at an early age. And I got involved in sexual relations at an early age. And I started watching snuff movies, which are movies where people actually get killed, or live movies, actual movies where people get killed. And I looked at, you know, True Detective magazines, and then, you know, pornography, and then violent pornography. And then eventually I got around to acting out these thoughts in my head about being a predator and going after women, raping them, brutally beating them and killing them. So I think the reason I got off track was because of my experiences in childhood. Now, of course, a lot of people look at that and say, well, Ted, that's kind of convenient, since you're getting put to death tomorrow, that you would go to this pastor and tell him, you know, these things. He might have been telling the truth. I don't know. He's a psychopath, so psychopaths have a really good ability to lie. So I don't know. Could have been the truth. We all know that childhood trauma does affect people's lives as adolescents and adults, and it may put them on a track that they're not going to recover from. We have Richard Ramirez from our old hometown here in El Chuco town, who turned out to be a serial killer and had a pretty good life for a while, and then sort of got off the rails. So here's your opportunity to ask me any questions off the study guide. So let me know if you have questions, because I'm going to look up this video. And I found it. Oh, nice. And show you this video on the other computer, since I come on. I don't know how to run it on my computer and allow you to see it. And now I can't get the chapter 4 not responding. Yeah, I noticed that. Man, can imagine how frustrating this is. Just open a simple file. What is your problem? Now it opens immediately. It's crazy. Okay. Any of you have any questions? Melanie. Okay. I will answer that. We have a half an hour for sure. I will answer them. I forgot to print out the study guide, so I'll do that while we're watching this video. Wake up. All right, sounds like it's gonna work. Okay. Now go back to the video. And no volume. Why stop? Why don't we have any volume? I know why. Shut it off because I got tired of hearing that ding, ding every time I was working. So I just shut it off. Okay, let's try it again. Do two things at once. Okay. That, of course, is a condom ad from a different country, which is why it's got the English subtitles. I use that for my human sexuality class, but I love that But it's instructive because you say to yourself, how did that kid learn that when he doesn't get what he wants, which is his favorite cereal, that he acts out? And when he doesn't get the response that he wants, he ups the ante. So it comes from, starts at just, you know, demanding it and yelling about it, and then pushing the card and throwing things and throwing more things, and eventually ending up on the floor throwing his little tantrum. Okay, these things happen. You've probably heard, since we're talking about two-year-olds, the term the terrible twos, because there is so often head-to-head conflict between two-year-olds and their adult caretakers. It has something to do with development. They're testing the world, they're testing the limits. And the behavioralists are correct. So if you're one of these people like me who go to a restaurant, which I'm going to do right after class today, and go have breakfast, and I happen to know that there's not going to be screaming kids like that, but sometimes I go to a restaurant and there are screaming kids like that. And you think, why don't people do something about that? What the hell is the matter with these parents? And you answer the question by your question. What the hell is the matter with these parents? The answer is, or what's the matter with this kid? It's the parents. That's the answer. Yes, it is parents. Now, how does this reinforcement occur? Here's what usually happens, and you've seen this in the grocery store. Maybe a parent will tell them, okay, we're not going to buy candy today. All we're here is to buy this and this and this. You want your one cereal, I'll get you that one cereal, and that's it. No candy, no nothing else. So I don't want to hear about it. And then what happens? The kid sees something in the line and they want it. Either while you're going through the store or when you're waiting in line, you'll notice that some stores are actually so child development aware that they will put up a sign and say, in this aisle, in this checkout lane, there are no candies or toys. Because what happens, you've got a kid in the grocery cart and you're sitting in there and you're waiting. And then to their immediate left or right are all sorts of candies and little toys and all this stuff. And it's just begging them to want them and do something about it. The reason that grocers put them there is because they want adults to do that. If you weren't thinking about buying a candy bar and then you're in line and all of a sudden you have all these candy bars and treats next to you, you might think, what? I'll do that. And I better check these chats. Hopefully nobody's telling me that you couldn't watch the movie. No, okay, cool. And they say, no, you're not gonna do that. I told you we're not gonna do that. So the kid just wails more, louder, stronger, starts kicking the grocery cart. Then the mom or the caretaker does the behavioral thing that the behavioralists are saying is toxic, and they are correct. They say, hey, all right, look, I'm gonna get you this candy bar, and you gotta shut up. No more crying. Are you willing to shut up and stop crying? Yes. Okay, here's your candy bar. And they eat it, that's the end of the story. Well, what have you done? You have told the kid, if you want something, and if the answer is no, then you have to insist on it. And if the answer is still no, then you have to really loudly exist in, like in the Zazu condom commercial, you have to up the ante. And you know this father is not reinforcing this behavior. He just lets it happen because he can't stop it. I mean, he could beat on the kid, but that's not a good option. So let the kid have his damn tantrum. Now, in this case, you're doing that much destruction. You can't let a kid do that. I told you not to stick a pin in the electrical outlet in the wall. So if you're going to do that, let's see what happens. So as your kid electrocutes yourself, you're giving them a lecture. I told you it was going to hurt. I told you it might kill you. It did. No, no, no. That's not the way you do things. You got to. What's obvious in this video is, I mean, it's not true. Obviously, it's an advertisement. But what it depicts is somebody who was parented by somebody who would always break down if the kid just raised the vitriol and screaming louder and the activities louder because they get too embarrassed and they just want to shut the kid up and they need to get groceries because they're at a store or they're at a restaurant, which is my pet peeve because I like to go out and eat. And I didn't come to the restaurant to listen to somebody else's screaming kid. And you've all heard it. Mom, 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 mom. And they're grabbing the mom's arm. Mom, mom. And mom's just talking along, ignoring the kid. Well, do you have to pay attention to your kid every time they want to interrupt you? No. But you can give them a stern warning. I ask you not to interrupt me when I'm having an adult conversation. When I am done with this point, I will talk to you. So be quiet, sit down, be quiet, and quit grabbing my arm. Mom, mom, mom. Well, then it's time to take the kid out and take him in the car, whether you believe in corporal punishment and spank him, or you just take him in the car, which is basically a timeout. And that way you don't have to get embarrassed and he doesn't get your attention. He gets the attention that it takes to take him out of the situation. Like in this grocery store, the male caretaker would have had to pick him up and drag him out or lift him up and take him out. I am not a perfect parent, but my son tried this one time at a restaurant and I told him, you know, if you don't stop demanding these things, I'm going to take you out into the car. And of course, he doesn't know what's going to happen in the car, but he didn't think it was going to be a good thing. So he did it and we were at a restaurant and I picked him up and I took him in the car and I put him in the back seat and he started crying. So fine, go ahead, cry. I didn't wail on him. I didn't hit him at all. And guess what? That happened one time. One time. And my second wife, who had a son, who pretty big ADHD-er, when we were dating, we would have dinner at the house and he would play with his food. He's not young. He's like 6 years old. He's got his finger fooling around with his food, right? And later on, we talked about it with his mother and I talked about it. And I said, do you want me to stop that? I can stop that. Really? I said, but I'm not even going to try it unless I have your 100% support. Because if you go around me, then it's not going to work. Well, what are you going to do? You're going to beat him? No. No. I'm going to tell him. We don't play with our food. This is why you have a fork and a spoon. And if you insist on playing with your food, then you're not interested in eating. So I'm going to take your food away from you and you're going to go to your room and you're not getting fed tonight. That's what I'm going to tell him. And my prediction is, since he's been doing this for not 7 years, but maybe 4 or 5 years, he's going to test it. He's going to go, who the hell is this guy? Well, he knows who I am, but I mean, who is he to come in here and tell me the rules of this house? And so he did. He did it that night. And so I took the plate away, put it in the sink, got him, escorted him to his room, closed the door, and then in the room he has his temper tantrum. Again, he's not 2 years old. He's the age of this kid in this video. And he starts throwing things around in his bedroom and all that crap. I told her, don't go in there. Do not go in there. And so, you know, that settled down 15 minutes and you couldn't hear him, whatever he was doing. It was quiet. Never happened again. One time, never happened again. So it's not that I'm that amazing of a child psychologist. Well, maybe I am, but not. That's not the, that example doesn't prove it. But I happen to believe in corporal punishment. Most psychologists say that's stupid. All it does is teach your kid to be aggressive, and if they're bigger than somebody else, like you're bigger than them and you can spank them, then when they find somebody smaller than them, like their little brother or little sister, then they don't give them what they want, then they can spank them, because that's what you teach them, social learning. You know, don't you remember Albert Bandura and, you know, Bobo the Clown, which we will see later on in this class. Yes, I do know that. I actually show it in my classes. So yes, I'm fully aware of Albert Bandura. But Albert Bandura shows that people learn by social interaction, and that's true. So doesn't mean and by the way, I spanked my son one time. My daughter, I never spanked her. So there are all sorts of other options available to you. And if your child understands that when you say something, you mean it and you will follow through with it, even if it's embarrassing because it's in a public setting, they learn that they can make a choice. As a matter of fact, with this stepson of mine, well, after we got married, he was my stepson. He, one time, I can't believe he did this, but, and again, kids will surprise you. He was sent to his room, which is usually a pretty good timeout, good punishment without having to wail on somebody. And he went upstairs to go to his room, and he decided to go in the bathroom and rip down the shower curtain and start throwing things around the bathroom. So I went in there and I did apply physical punishment to him and put him in his room. And so in an attempt not to have to repeat that, the next night, because the argument was going to bed, it was time to go to bed. He didn't want to go to bed. Most kids don't want to go to bed, but when you're ADHD, got some behavioral problems, maybe you are more insistent on not going to bed than others. So 9 o'clock is his bedtime. 5 minutes before nine, I called him into where I was and I said, look, your bedtime's coming up in 5 minutes. So remember last time when I was here and you didn't want to go to your bed? We're going to do something different this time. If you want me to chase you up the stairs and start whipping your hind end, you're going to have to tell me now, because you got 5 minutes to think about it. So if you want me to do that, tell me and I'll do it. Okay? But that's the only way I'm going to do it, is if you tell me. 9 o'clock came. He didn't say anything. He went upstairs and he went in his room. One time. So, but he was older, of course, he was 6, 7. So he had the cognitive abilities to understand the relationship. When kids are really young, like, you know, 2, they don't necessarily always understand the relationship. If they're not cognitively online to understand relationships, then it doesn't work. It's like telling your son, if you pick up your room when your mother asks you to do it, then we're going to go to Disneyland. Disneyland? Oh, yeah, great. Oh, I love Disneyland. Ah! Of course, we can't go until Christmas break or summer. So today is February the 11th, I think. February the 11th. Okay, after school's out in May, we're going to go to Disneyland. Okay, but only if you do what your mother tells you. Well, 5 minutes later, the kid might remember that you said that, but the incentive of going to Disneyland is not going to be that much of an incentive because they can't think that far ahead. I mean, you who are sitting in this class, I can say to you, if you attend these lectures or watch them recorded and fill out your study guide, you will do fine on your test, and your test will be added up at the end of the semester. You will get a good grade, and that good grade will go into your grade point average, which will help you get into the nursing program or into med school or whatever you want to do. Okay. Well, you as an adult can say, okay, yeah, I got this goal, I'm working towards this goal. You cannot expect a 6 or 8 or 9 year old to be able to focus their behavior and suppress their drive to do something that's non-productive, because 4 months from now, you're going to get to go to Disneyland. Now, there's all sorts of behavioral ways that you can help with that. Like at school, they give you stars and they put them on a board, or they put them on a sheet of paper, and you can look at your progression of stars and all that kind of stuff. There's ways of visually reminding them or whatever. They need more help. You don't need that. I don't need to tell you every time we meet. Now, remember, students, if you do what I ask you to do, you will do well in this class and it will help you. And that. I don't need to tell you that. You know that. You have the ability as an adult to understand that relationship. But, you know, as an example of a woman who was at work and she didn't read the entire introduction employee handbook. And right in the handbook, it says, okay, you're expected to do this kind of work, and this is what you get paid to do. However, if you go above and beyond the minimum, the company will keep track of that. And in Christmas, or when it's time to review your salary, we will reward you based on these extra things that you did. If you want to, we're not telling you have to do it, but if you want to, it will help you get promoted and we'll get you a Christmas bonus or whatever. Well, she didn't read that. And so therefore she didn't do that. So she's sitting at her job just doing the normal work, bitching that she doesn't get any gifts at the end of the year, or she's not getting promoted or salary increase. You have to understand it. You have to, you know, obviously that was a failing of the boss. The boss needs to let you know what the incentives are. Why would you work for an incentive you didn't know existed? You know, I don't have to tell you that. You know that if you do well in this class, it'll go on your GPA and that'll help you one step more towards your eventual goal. So, all right, where are my questions? Question 8. Which event is the least likely to evoke proximity-seeking behavior? Well, what provokes proximity-seeking behavior? Some kind of stress in your life. You're sick, somebody broke up with you, You've got a big test you're worried about, or whatever this deal is that's going to give you stress. Let's look at the options. A, learning you have a serious disease. Well, is that going to get you to go talk to mom and dad or your, maybe even your ex? Yeah, that is, yeah, it's life and death, and you are definitely going to want some comfort, and it is going to evoke proximity seeking behavior. So A is not the answer. B, listening to your boss insult you. Well, that might make you seek some proximity seeking app after work, or maybe on work if you can call somebody or text them. So let's look at B. Now let's look at C. Leaving for a dangerous part of the world. Well, like if you're in the military going on deployment, yeah, that's a serious thing. You might get killed. So that is going to evoke proximity seeking behavior. And then finally, D, arriving at a job. Of course, when it says a job, I mean it's your job, not arriving for a job interview, but arriving at a job. Why should you be anxious and need assistance, emotional support when you're just going to work? So definitely A and C. B, nobody likes being insulted. It would probably make us want to think about it. So remember, this is one of those negative questions, which is the least likely to get you to proximity. Okay, you already answered 12. Is indifferent to the human world. If you looked at those Dr. Renee Spitz movies, videos of anaclytic depression, well, I'm sorry, this is 1 month old. I was thinking 1 year old. 1 month old, she is indifferent to the human world. What are we going after here? No wonder this question is confusing. Mayumi is 1 month old. She most likely, A, happily smiles at every adult, true. C, only goes, that's the wrong damn answer. I hate it when they do that. Only goes to her primary caregiver, wrong. C, D, has two or three people she really likes, wrong. Am I reading this question wrong? If Miami is 1 month old, she most likely. Okay. Well, hey, Melanie, what you say you figured out 12. What is your answer?
I'm going based off of when my kid was a 1 month old and she was just, you know, she went to anyone. She was 4 weeks old. So I put indifferent because I don't, at 1 month old.
Okay. I see what okay. All right. You, of course, smarter than me. You got the answer. By indifference, they mean you treat the whole world the same. You don't discriminate. Yeah. See, when I read indifferent, I read it as they didn't give a damn.
Right.
That's why I was thinking it was like a one-year-old and they're indifferent. I'm thinking, oh my God.
I was just remembering when Peyton was 4 weeks old, anyone could hold her. She'd go to anyone.
Absolutely.
She was
content. Absolutely. Yeah. That's absolutely true.
Yeah.
So I'm glad you asked that question because I wouldn't put this on the test anyway, because I look at the word indifferent differently. To me, if I wanted to make this the right answer, I would say, does she act Does she not discriminate among people in her human world? The answer would be yes. She does know who mom is, but other people she's going to treat equally as well as mom. It's just that mom has a special relationship because of the voice and the face, by the way. So I can never pass my own test because I read too much into the question, or not enough. When you said that, I thought, what the hell are you talking about? Okay, then it became obvious to me. We both of us are right. It's just the way you define indifferent. I don't think that's a good word. I wouldn't use it, and I would not use that question for the test, which is why I'm glad you asked that. That is perfect. All right, 14, attachment in the making, which I do not like that term at all. I will not use that one on the test either. Coincides with the onset of what? Secondary circular reactions? Primary, oh my God. See, I don't even like that concept. That's why, I don't even know why I put that on there. I should have been more discriminating. The answer according to the book is C. And since I don't subscribe to attachment in the making, I believe attachment starts actually in the womb because the kid knows what mom's voice is. So that's pretty important. That's a type of attachment, and it begins in the womb. And of course, it definitely begins in day one with the adult caretakers in their life, whether they're nurses, doctors, dad, mom, Uncle Larry, whoever. If they're, they're not going to remember much of anything from day one. But consistency, I mean, that's the whole idea of attachment. It's consistency over time. And if you read or look at some of those videos or discussions about attachment, the general neuropsychological view is it happens between day one and around 24 months. And the first year is really concentrating on essential needs like food and shelter and care. And then from one to two, it's more on the social side, because as you just mentioned, they get to that age where stranger danger, and you can no longer look inside their crib or whatever you're pushing them around in and not get upset. And there comes a time when that happens because whoever's doing this is out of their group of repertoire of faces that they recognize. And so then the question is, how often do they have to see that face to keep that memory alive? Does your sister come visit you? But she only visits once a month. Is that going to be enough? Maybe not, maybe so. But I told you about my experience in Chihuahua. When I went in that grocery store and this middle-aged Hispanic woman comes over there, or American Hispanic, obviously, Mexican woman comes up to me and starts wanting to look at the child. And I said, Dennis? Oh, yeah, man. Bam, took that kid. And the next lady was fighting to get her turn. And complete strangers in a freaking grocery store. Let alone if you go to a big fiesta with your relatives, everybody in the damn place, and their friends they brought. Everybody wants to see the newborn because that's a thing that they value. And I think that's great. And children benefit from that. So, okay, I'm not even going to, the answer is C, but don't worry about that. It's not any, I'm surprised I didn't cut that out. And very next one too, clear-cut attachment, it's stupid. It's arbitrary. And since I don't personally believe it, I wouldn't put it on a test. So I'll just let all of you know, that anything it has to do with, and I'm sorry I didn't cut those two out. I thought I did a better job, but I guess I didn't. 98. Babies most require temperament-friendly child-rearing when they are, from the beginning, temperamental. And the book says, and they're for the most part right, that a child's temperament is going to be set by the bio side of biopsychosocial. So if they have colic or they've got some other issue that's making them unhappy physically, this child that's of mine that's in the Philippines is coming up on 2 years in May, now is having a lot of problems with, I guess, being exposed to water that has parasites in it, and it's giving him a lot of digestive issues. So again, that's only when he's sick and, you know, he has to take medicine and it's over with. But if a kid is being maltreated or the environment, there's something going on in there, that is going to affect them, and it is going to affect the way they attach, and then that can lead to even more problems. So babies most require temperament-friendly child-rearing when there is a biological issue like colic or some other, like somebody who is overreactive. They have an overreactive autonomic nervous system where things in the environment really upset them. Children who are, they don't have to have mental illness to have these problems. They just could have a sensitivity. Autistic, schizophrenic kids, of course, they have their proclivities where they're going to not like noise or loud or what light or other things like that. But you don't have to be mentally ill to have these problems. Just normal child development, you can be sensitive to certain issues. And what it takes is the dance, like Matisse back here, except there's no kids in that, which is good because everybody's naked. But anyway, kids and their caretakers, if they can get this dance done, then the kid will thrive. And if they can't, then there's going to be problems. And I told you I was going to do this. I think I told you I was going to do this, and then I didn't do it. Let me find that video. Put it on page one so I can remember. I got to write myself notes, I forget. I will post, I can't post it. How do I do that? Well, I can do a video from YouTube about the woman who's the works in animal studies. They used to call it animal husbandry. I forgot what the word they use, but it's basically people who study animals and how to deal with animals. So not veterinarians, but otherwise. So I can't show you the tape. If this was face-to-face, maybe I would, but if I can upload it, I will. If not, the minimum I will do is find a video about her. And the one I was thinking about is the one where the person from Europe comes and interviews her. And she's got the University of Illinois blanket on her couch, which is great. But it's Halloween. And so I think they're from France. This French lady is interviewing her, and the doorbell's ringing, and she's getting up and giving them what she hands out for Halloween. And being on the spectrum, she hands out coins that she has received by going to all these countries that she goes to speak to. So rather than give them a piece of candy, she gives them a foreign coin and probably explains a little bit. These are coins from the Philippines. These are coins from Germany, whatever. And I'll post that. Before I go eat, I'll go post that because I will forget it again. So that was 98, right? Genetically prone to react intensely to the environment. That is correct. And they're going to need some kind of accommodation. And parents hopefully can figure that out without assistance. But if not, a good pediatrician hopefully would be informative about that. There's another video that I show of a guy who is a savant, and his father tells the story about, you know, the specialist told him, your kid's severely retarded. He'll never walk, talk, or chew gum. So you might as well just put him in an institution now and call it quits, because he's not going to amount to anything except draining you and your wife of all their energies. And the father wouldn't accept that. And so he upped the game. Interesting. I don't know what he did for a living, but somehow he was able to basically give this kid 100% of his attention, and the mom left. The mom was so devastated that this kid was so needy that she left. And in the Temple Grandin story, the Dr. Grandin, the one I was telling you about that was severely a autism spectrum disorder, her mother quit, but her father had a great job, very wealthy. And mom didn't have to work after that and spent her entire child rearing taking care of Temple. And it was a pain in the butt, but look at the results. I mean, you don't get to see her as a severely autistic child, but you got mom telling you how she acted, which is clearly she was severely autistic. And she turned out really well. Now, she's not married. She doesn't have kids. I don't think she'll ever get in a relationship because of her situation, but that's just my belief. All right. Any of the rest of you, thank you so much for asking those questions, Melanie. You always pick the really good questions to ask, because there are problems, and there always has been problems in this class, and I try to be better at cutting those questions out. I failed on this other idea of close, clear-cut attachment, and I don't know, these other, it's a ridiculous argument. Why talk about it? But that's my prejudice. Okay. Oh, Melanie figured out 12. You already told me that. Okay. That's good. You figured out what indifference meant. I just, that's not the right word. Indifference. If you're indifferent, you don't give a damn. Well, yeah, but they don't give a damn about what kid it is, what parent it is, what neighbor it is. Well, that's indifference. Sounds like I just don't give a damn. You know, I'm just like the kid in the Dr. Spitz, where they're just, now that's indifference to the world. That's self-stimulation.
Yeah, when she hit 6 months old, she was like, no. She didn't want anybody. She's like, no. So, and now she's 3 and a half, and now she's like, okay. All right.
And she's
precocious. That's interesting.
A little precocious, a little before her time. And, yeah. Are there any other kids in the family? How does she get along with other kids?
She's very outgoing. She's very charismatic. She loves playing with older kids. And she's very smart.
Kids? She's above.
She likes younger kids, but she gravitates towards older kids.
Because they're more challenging. She's
And she has a very expanded vocabulary. Wow, so she talks like a five-year-old. And the little ones, she's told me, Mommy, that girl in my class doesn't talk.
Right.
And so she gravitates towards older ones because she can talk to them and communicate with them.
So I'll embarrass you on tape here and say this kid is above average intelligence. She's engaging in the world, and it's no surprise to you or to me that she actually likes older kids because their level of understanding, their vocabulary, their excellent observation is greater because she's,
My sister's an educator, and she's really smart. She teaches 4 and 5 year olds, and
I'm sure you're being a sensitive mom, is sensitive to the point where you know she benefits from, which is a way of saying needs, benefits from more academic, more intellectual challenges because she'll eat it up. Take her to the museum and she can look at, can't take her over to the Louvre, but
yeah,
take her to a museum. Yeah. Take her to, the Children's Museum or anything of those things, take her to demonstrative arts like dance or singing or whatever. Yeah. They all benefit from that.
And
it's not really too early to see if she has an interest in a particular instrument too, because music is wonderful too. And will all
she likes piano. And she sings a lot. She makes up her own lyrics.
It just doesn't surprise me. For all the rest of you, this is not normal child behavior. Normal does not mean a bad thing or a good thing. No. This is beyond normal behavior, which is indicative of somebody who's really smart and is engaging in the world. That's why they have an interest in singing and trying to either listen to music or pound on a piano. And it's just amazing what kids can do. But if you're open to it, you expose. That's the reason you should expose your children to all of this stuff. And as I mentioned, not just now, this one will probably be nonstop. She will not stop. But some kids, sort of maybe after two or something, they're not so that engaging. Well, as I always say, remember when they get to that 10, 11-year-old, when they start doing that synapto pruning, you want those neural pathways, like for singing and music and demonstrative art, those kinds of things, or physical art as well, those neural pathways will persist through lifetime, because in that early adolescence, with synaptic pruning going on, it's always use it or lose it. So with both of my Mexican-American kids, they were exposed to music and they didn't stick with it. And I didn't force them to do that. Now, I've heard from people who end up being wonderful singers and wonderful musicians, they say, thank God my mom made me take those damn piano lessons and wouldn't let me go play unless I did, and blah, blah, blah. You know, I just... Find that on Apple Music. Cállate. Pinche Siri. Okay. Yeah, stimulation. I don't think you're going to have to worry about that with her. She's going to do it herself. But certainly think about, and I'm sure you do, opportunities that... this is where Berger's point is on point. The SES issue. I mean, literally, if you had the kind of money to fly to Paris and go to the Louvre, yeah, that would be great. But in absence of that, you can go to the Children's Museum in El Chuco here. And who's to know, I don't know what you or your the baby's father has any interest of their own into music or art or dance or fabrics or throwing pottery, whatever it is. She'll eat it up and she will benefit. And for all the rest of you, it not only benefits them because they now know how to throw a pot or something, they now know how to do a silk screen or something, it helps them academically. And this is a problem we have in the United States, because when we have limited funding for things, the first thing we do is cut out art and arts and crafts and physical education, trips to the museum because they're expensive, and all that kind of stuff, because it's just extra. You should be focusing on writing, reading, and arithmetic. Well, yeah, that's true. But what you need to understand, you, the educators, need to understand, is that when you have this exposure to music, art, dance movement, there, there is proof as we speak. Hi there. So, yeah. You can, hey, by the way, you can come watch me in this class. You might not learn much, not because of you, but because of me, but you're certainly welcome. So anybody else have any other questions? Amber, I see you're still with us. You got any questions?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you for hanging around. As always, the test will be released tomorrow. We'll have, gosh, it's already Thursday. Wow, what a week. We will meet at 10 to cover any other questions or any other issues. And as always, you have the whole weekend to fill it out. Work on your writing assignment. It's not that difficult, but you do have to devote some time to watching the videos and reading a couple articles on it. And do that. If you need extra time, let me know. And you can get that. Hopefully you'll be able to attach your writing onto the assignment. Sometimes that works, sometimes it doesn't for people. If you can't get it to work, then just stick it in the email, send it to me that way. All right, as always, got a question, let me know. And see you tomorrow around 10. Adios.
Bye. Thank you, bye.
Auf Wiedersehen. Ciao. We'll do some different languages for fun.